Ready, Carla.
Time to go watch some Macho Man.
Marching up and down the field.
Battle head to head, who takes the crown?
Yo, welcome back to the show, man. We are here, man. Monday night, Arrange of Battles. I'm your host.
Yo, meet me
on the 50.
The show, man. We are here, man. Monday.
Turn this dope beat off right here, man. Shout out to Low on the Beats, man. I'm your host, Eddie Evans, man. Meet me on the 50. We got something special tonight, y'all. You saw the screen. Let me pull it back up right quick, man. You see it. All right. We got two great arrangers on tonight, man. Two legendary arrangers, right? Legends in the making right here, man. Kev Johnson, Jackson State. Larry Jenkins, Tennessee State, man. It's going down tonight, y'all. If you haven't already, go ahead and hit that like button. Subscribe to the channel. Stick around, man. Let everybody know what we're doing over here. Meet me on the 50. Go ahead and share this out to all your friends on social media. Get them over here, y'all. We need to have a good audience tonight because it's going down, man. It's about to be one of them special nights. I feel it, y'all. Shout out to all the Wrench crew in the comments, man, holding it down while we having the show going on tonight, man. Shout out to Low on the Beats, all right? Any beats you hear on the show tonight will be courtesy of Low, a.k.a. YOLO on Instagram, all right? Follow him at Y-O underscore L-E-A-U-X on Instagram. If you rap, sing, do poetry, whatever you need, man, he got you, all right? Hey, without further ado, let's go ahead and bring on the men of the hour right here, Professor Johnson and Professor Jenkins.
Good evening.
What's happening, fellas?
Nothing much. How you doing this evening, guys?
All right. I got a little echo in the headphones right here.
All right.
Let me try it again. Check. I still hear it. Let me take you off, Larry. Let me work with Kev real quick. Check. Yeah, that's on yours, Kev.
All right, let me get some headphones real quick.
All right. Check. You good, Larry?
I'm good. You good?
Okay, yeah, it's no echo on yours. Let me bring Kev back on.
All right,
there we go.
I got some phones on. We good?
Yeah. All right, look. We have Mr. Larry Jenkins, Mr. Kevan Johnson, man. If you don't know about these two, like if you're in the band world, you already know who these men are right here. But for those that don't know, let's go ahead and start with Larry. Give him a little bit about yourself, a little bit about your band facts, Mr. Jenkins. And give the people a little something about yourself.
So originally from Portsmouth, Virginia. I actually went from high school. I'm a TSU undergrad. Graduate of Howard University for grad school. And been at TSU now for going on 7 years. And shoot, loving being there and doing my thing, man.
Absolutely. So you graduated from TSU?
Yep, for sure.
Oh, man. Yeah, so you homegrown. All right, how about you, Mr. Johnson?
Born and raised in New Orleans, graduated from McMaine. Went to Jackson State. Graduated from Jackson State in 2005 and went to Indiana Purdue for music tech after that. And I taught middle school and high school for 13 or so years before I got to Jackson State.
Wow, so y'all been doing it for a minute right here, man. So I want to say it was 19 years for yourself, right, Mr. Johnson?
No, I was at 22.
22 years arranging, man. Mr. Jenkins, I think he was at 19, right?
Yeah.
Either way, man, these dudes been at it for a minute, so expect tonight to be full of some great music, but also, man, just some gems here and there. I'm sure these gentlemen will drop. Man, if you're new to the band directing game, new to the arrangement game, you went for a treat tonight, y'all.
For sure.
So the way this works, man, people ask about the voting system. There's no voting, man. We here. This is for the fans right here. This is really just for the love of the culture right here. Yeah. Any questions for me y'all have? Mr. Jenkins, Mr. Johnson?
I'm good, man.
I'm good. Just excited to be up here with y'all brothers.
Absolutely. Let's have some fun.
Absolutely. So the way we always kick off the battles on Meet Me on the 50, man, I got a trusty old silver quarter right here, man. All right? So we normally give the eldest of the two the pick, you know, heads or tails. So I think that's you, Mr. Johnson. So let's... You want heads or tails, bro?
Let's go tails.
Tails? All right, let's go. Landed on my chest. Look. Like, Gladys won the Super Bowl, man. All right, tails it is. You want first or second, Mr. Johnson?
I'll go second.
Second. All right. So what we gonna do right here, Mr. Jenkins is gonna send me a clip, and we gonna get it started. We gonna probably go for at least 8 rounds. If they wanna go longer, look, we gonna do it, man, okay? Let me shout out to the comment section real quick. And y'all, share this out to all your people, y'all. All right, Mr. Jenkins' clip is in. I'm gonna take myself off the screen real quick, fellas. Hey, feel free to go ahead and just talk to each other, man, and, you know, chop it up a little bit. You know, let the people know. That's one thing we want to make sure we understand. Look, schools, we battle in the fall, you know what I'm saying? But it's always camaraderie, man. Behind closed doors, man, these band directors, they all talk, you know what I'm saying? It's nothing what y'all might think as far as this hatred and all this other kind of stuff, man. It's all love out here in this HBCU band world. So let's exhibit that tonight with a little bit of competitive spirit as well, you know?
For sure. I think folks don't even know that, like how much we talk and shoot, how much of these experiences out the same for us. So, yeah, that's definitely a good point. It is all love. It's just like the sports.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
I guess we wait, man. Brother Kev, what's good with you, man?
Nothing much. I do want to take the time. I see a lot of both of our students, and I even see one of my classmates and from high school, college.
Oh, wow.
I appreciate all those folks turning in and, turning up, rather, both sides, you know, just to support both of us on staff and everything. I see Mr. Simmons out there. I don't want to get too wrapped up in protocol and then offend somebody because I left them off. But, you know, I really do appreciate people turning out and checking us out.
For sure, for sure. And at the core of all of it anyway, man, it's for the culture, man.
Absolutely.
I planned on speaking about this at some point anyway, but I love the fact that, you know, our bands have personalities and have characteristics that make us who we are because it keeps the culture interesting. I just love that about what's going on. Like even me and you right here, you know, we can hear one thing and you get two different perspectives of it. It's art.
Absolutely.
And, you know, there's a lot of beauty in that. So I'm glad to be a part of this today. It's gonna be lit.
All right, we ready, fellas. We ready to get this thing started?
All right.
Yeah.
All right, here we go, y'all. This is Larry Jenkins. He's up first. Round one, here we go. Meet me on the 50th Rangers battle Monday night. Let's go. Hey, share this out. Get everybody over here, y'all. Here we go.
Thank you.
hit you with the power tune. So we can go ahead and run that first round. Let's go ahead and let's go for it. Let's do it.
Let's go, man.
Let's do it.
All right, clip is in. This is round one. This is Mr. Johnson, y'all. Mr. Johnson, round one. Let's go.
When did y'all premiere that one?
2004. That was that's been a minute.
Dang, sleep. Dang. Okay. You've been in the game for a minute. So remember that from actually way back then.
Yeah, yeah. Well, 2004, that was my senior year in the band, and that's when we finally got out. I want to say somewhere around the top of the season, this first time we got it going.
What, was that your first arrangement for y'all?
No, it wasn't. It was the first one I think got some time to it. But, yeah, that was one of the early ones that I did with him.
Word.
Yeah, that was clean. Hey, so people watching, this will be arrangements by both of these men right here, man. Regardless of the program they was affiliated with, they could have been part of a high school program. This is all about the arrangements that they've ever written in their career, man. All right? So that was round one, man. We about to get into round two. It's back on you, Larry.
All right, so I'm switching the mood like drastically.
Yeah.
Already, but yeah, this one I know for the arrangers on my side, this is really big for Color, and I'm not about to preach or anything, but for the arrangers, Color is very big. You can listen real careful because this is in the band room. It's a band room clip. You can listen careful for the woodwinds because it's up front anyway because it's practice. So listen to the clarinets and how they're blended in this open line black baritones. And they just have them with the baritones and the tenors, just like these different colors that you'll hear throughout it. So check this one on out.
It's good to be able to hear some clips in the band room when you're, you know, because I think sometimes woodwinds get a little bit lost in that open air. You know, I, quite honestly, we're really fortunate to have some aggressive woodwinds. I mean, they're going to make sure you hear them with headphones on across the field underneath the ground. But, you know, that chance to hear all of the colors of, of what a band is doing is always real, real refreshing. I guess I'll set up this next one. One thing I really try to talk to the students about is like how music invokes emotions and feelings and memories and things like that. It doesn't always have to be, you know, one particular thing, but just always, you know, it might make you think of some fine time or, you know. And so this next tune came out when I was in middle school, and, you know, it just kind of makes me think of those early 90s and stuff like that. And I just, you know, fond memories and all that good stuff. So you can go ahead and roll the clip, man.
So. Childhood for sure, right there, man.
Yeah, man. It's a friend of mine, actually my old college roommate. We used to talk about that song all the time. And you know, when you see somebody that's real passionate about picking a song, it's like, okay, let me take a listen to it again. And Dr. Little and I and the band were at something at the gym, pep rally, something like that. And the tune came on, and the whole crowd started singing, and we just looked at each other like, yeah, we got to make sure that's in the book this year.
Oh yeah. The more organic moments be the best ones.
Yeah. Just pull it, like, got to start writing stuff down on a piece of paper so you can remember it and pull it out, you know, and make sure you get that stuff that hits people.
I ask you a question to both of y'all. When you write a song, for example, we're in 2020 now. Let's say you wrote that song 2010, for example. How often do you go back and fine-tune arrangements if you decide to bring it back?
Quite a bit.
Quite a bit?
Yeah, they need some renovation most of the time. But I'll go back and look at old stuff. I try to keep track of old stuff because you never really want to forget where you come from and kind of where you've grown and things like that too. So, you know, I try to look at it so I can ask myself what I was thinking back then and learn from those previous attempts.
For me too, to add on to that, it's like a band changes. So even if it's slight, you know, there can be changes in your strengths and, you know, you want to highlight certain things, certain times. So, you know, sometimes I'll go back and grab an old arrangement and start to look for, ways to make it more current, as you were saying, to fit the strengths of where the band is at the current time.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Hey, this was that was round two, y'all. So we're moving on to the third round. We back on Mr. Larry Jenkins, and the clip is in. Let's go, round three.
We're going back. To the 90s again. That inspired me on that one. That was definitely dope. So I'm going to hit some 92.
Let's do it. Let's do it.
Don't let that jump make me think of all that. I feel like they perform better up here.
Right. When music videos were brand new.
You hear me?
Oh, man. Hey, hey, Mr. Jenkins. The song you sent me, you ain't sent me that video, brother.
Really?
No, I don't have it. I can pull up a version of it, but I don't have that in your list of songs, man.
Oh, yeah. Probably the first one.
First one?
Should be like across the field. It's clear. Okay. It's
all right, let's go. We're gonna find a good one. Let's go. I know a song you want. Here we go.
Yeah.
Something when that song pulls out those old memories and all that kind of like that skating rink music and that bowling alley music from you. That's fine memories, man. Just thinking about that time and everything. I'm gonna pull up to this year with that next tune. And with this one, I was really, I think I was trying to experiment with some stuff. It seemed like it at least landed on the right beats and everything. You know, we had again, like you were talking about, arranging specifically for the band that you're dealing with. We had a whole lot of tubas this year. So we tried a whole lot of experimentation. You know, we had some real solid, ladies and gentlemen back there. I see a couple of them in the chat, you know, shout out to y'all. You know, we put them through the ringer, and I think they bit every bullet we threw at them. So you go ahead and roll that next clip, man.
Thank you.
Nice, bro.
Appreciate it. So to talk to the people, to the Rangers and stuff out there, it's really tough for especially brass players to jump back and forth octaves and things like that. Mm-hmm. So when you arrange music, you know, consider the intervals that people are going to be jumping. So what I did for that one was made basically a first and a second part. So to split the section in half. So everybody's, you know, there's no way any power would have come out of that having sousaphones jumping up and down like that. So that's just kind of mm-hmm. explain the method of the madness. You know, if I was talking to some of our Rangers and we actually did some stuff like a couple of weeks ago. And one of the things I was telling them is the analogy I used was brush with the grain. You know, if you want to get waves, you brush with the grain. And it's basically saying, you know, your music will work better if you're naturally working with what the instrument was intended to do instead of trying to make people do all kind of crazy stuff with you know, with an instrument that wasn't meant to do that.
Mm-hmm. I got a question for you, Mr. Johnson. So I know you mentioned that you guys, you know, had crazy number of tubas this past season, but it's every season outside of 2019, man. Dog Team, you know, that's the tubas, if y'all are unfamiliar in the comments. Dog Team, they are always present. They have a very strong presence. Is that intentional?
Of course. I think every arranger that's worth their salt is going to listen to their band. And like Mr. Jenkins said, they're going to figure out, okay, this year I've got these folks and they killing it. And they're going to try to push the envelope a little bit more. But I, of course, the staff works hard at Jackson State, but I would be, I'd be way out of pocket if I didn't acknowledge the pride that the students have. You know, of course, every college band has a bunch of music majors in it, and they almost take it on like their own sections. You know, our woodwinds, our trumpet players, all of these folks, you know, you got music major section leaders that really, they're passionate about their section being good. And they try to teach, you know, as if they're preparing for their classrooms.
Absolutely. Okay. I was always curious, man, because Dog Team, their presence is always felt, man. So
thank you.
Shout out to y'all. All right, here we go, man. That was round, what, three?
Yes.
And the way we're going to do this, look, if you have questions for either of these gentlemen, I need you to send me a question via Instagram, all right? Meet me on the 50 on Instagram. Send me your questions, and I'll read them off, you know, throughout the show. All right, so here we go, man. It's back with you, Mr. Jenkins. Let's do it.
Let's do it. This is one of the ones that kind of went crazy a couple of years ago. Jumped out the box and, you know, tried to do something a little bit different. And it seemed to be received well. So hopefully everybody likes it today.
Hey, Mr. Jenkins, now was this on your list or this is another one that's not on the list you sent me?
It was, but maybe I slowed something up, man.
Yeah, I didn't see that one over here.
Oh, can I text it to you?
Yeah. Shoot it to me.
Gotta take care of that right there, cook. Shout out to everybody in the comments too.
All right, I got it. Here, let's go. Let's go. I'm gonna plug it in now. Here we go. Larry Jenkins, man, round four.
Thank you.
I love off the wall tunes like that.
Man, appreciate it.
Very good job, man. Enjoyed it.
Thank you, man. And a little quick note about that too. I know you already know, just having an arranger's ear, but you know, sometimes it's one of the things where you're watching a movie or watching TV, and you said like it happened when you were at the pep rally with Dr. Little, and it just bang, you hear it and you're like, ah, that's it. So right there on the spot. And that's kind of one of those that was one of those moments for me with that one. It wasn't necessarily planned, it just you hear it and it's bang, FOMO, because you know it's one of those that you know will resonate well.
Yeah, with, absolutely.
Yeah, man.
Now you catch it from movies, video games, TV shows, all over the place, man. It's just whenever music is music. And again, you know, we talk a lot about the skill of it. And of course, you got to have skill to back up what you're doing. But I think that it's so important that whatever you're listening to connects to you enough for you to make it connect to the students and for you to impress upon them to connect it to whoever's listening. You know, this is an art form. There's a reason that, you know, robots can't do this type of thing, man. I mean, if we had a big jukebox, automatic speaker system or something like that at a game, that takes away that whole HBCU experience is having that band in the stands and that passion and that camaraderie, that community and all that kind of stuff. Absolutely, man. Well, I'll set up the next clip since you hit me with the technical piece. I'm going to go completely in the opposite direction and go with a ballad. This is actually one of the tunes. I was working on some stuff. And you're always my motto on the flyer was everybody practice. Everything is practice for something. And you're always learning. You're always working to get better at something. And, you know, I would write saxophone parts a certain way. And I just kind of experimented here. And then I noticed, like, man, these saxes are speaking way better in this low range and this nice and fat and rich. Yeah, man. So I tried to use a little bit more of the saxes in that low range to kind of beef up the harmonies and things in there. So we can go ahead with that next clip.
Oh, nice. Yeah. Get up ready.
Thank you.
Nice, man.
Thanks, man. I appreciate it.
Neo Soul vibe.
Yeah, man. That one of those songs, I think. Matter of fact, I heard it at a friend of mine's wedding, and it kind of caught me off guard a couple, you know, years ago. And I was like, yeah, man, that's nice. You know, Music Soul Child has always had that kind of that real rich neo soul vibe and voice and all that kind of stuff.
Yes, sir.
Hey, gents, we got a question that came in through Instagram. D-Lo the Great asks, from the 2019 fall season, if you had to choose one arrangement, what was your favorite?
That was for me.
Nah, for both. Go ahead, Larry.
Oh, shoot. Man, I won't get ready.
All right.
Yeah, you got it.
What you think, Mr. Johnson?
I couldn't even tell you, man.
It's too much heat.
No, I don't think it's along those lines. I think you get to the point where, and think about it, the season itself. You got 10 games. You got Hondas. You got all kind of other stuff. Mm-hmm. And I think that it kind of changes over a while. So, like, at this point, you really enjoy this song. At another point, you enjoy this song. And, you know, I don't know. I really can't call it. I would say that it wasn't even just songs that I arranged for the band. It's, you know, stuff that we played all over the place that I really enjoyed hearing.
And, all right.
So you saying about stuff that maybe you didn't arrange for the band, that kind of sparked this in my mind. You know, one of my influences as far as arranging goes is someone who helped to teach me how to do it. I actually work with, and that's Prof Sexton at TSU. I've heard him be talked about on past shows like this. But yeah, sometimes it's the same thing with me. Like, one that I do might not necessarily be my favorite song from the season. He did Come and Talk to Me, I think 2 years ago. Fire. He did On and On. Fire. Definitely my favorite song from the season. It wouldn't be one, you know, that I did. So shout out to him, too.
Yeah, I mean, I sit up there, like, we were at Craig Fest, and one of the other bands played a tune that we had. And I could see the students, like, it was like somebody had a cold drink can just shaking it. I could see them. They were ready for it. And, you know, it ended up being what makes no sense. It ended up being one of my favorite songs, too. You know, because just the energy and everything that the students had from it. Mm-hmm. And I think that hype around it, you know, again, music is about that emotion, that passion. You think about the feelings you had when you listen to it. And I think that's definitely up in one of my top range tunes, you know, the energy the students got from it. And, you know, they were really excited. I every time I listened to it, I probably had it on repeat more than I care to admit. I know I folded a couple of loads of laundry, washed the car a couple of times and just let it roll the whole time.
Yeah, frowning up. Yeah.
Hey, fellas, we got a message from Mr. Carlson Wright from Alabama A&M. Band director. He just want to let everybody know, man, Mr. Jenkins and Mr. Johnson are blazing.
Oh, well, appreciate it. Thanks for the support, too.
OG.
Yeah. All right, let's go ahead and get into it, Larry. Next song. Here we go.
Way off from the last five. This was another practice, y'all. End of the night practice, actually. Endurance time.
Okay. We'll be right back. this is probably a horrible blanket generalization, but it's something about the key of D minor that bands can just easily eat up. I don't know. It's just got good notes for everybody.
It
puts everybody in the sweetest spots. I remember hearing that tune a while ago. Have y'all had it in the book for a minute?
Yeah, we played that in 2017.
Yeah, because I was teaching, taught middle school before, and I was in Memphis of all places, so plenty of Tennessee State folks. Hearing that tune, kind of catching, latching on to it. Yeah, man, that's good stuff.
Appreciate you, bro.
I just sent in my next round.
All right, look, we got a question that came in from another band director from Alabama A&M, Mr. Mario Warren. But you know what? Okay. I told him to come on here and what did he say? No BF. Oh, that was okay. I'm sorry. Yeah, Mario had a question for you, Larry. I'm gonna bring him on live in about a few minutes. All right.
I bet.
Here we go. Song is in, man. This is Mr. Johnson.
I'm gonna need to set this one up. So okay. I actually called to get clearance on this tune. Well, this particular clip, it's kind of like a band inside joke with the band members. But we always kind of talk to the students about how much we really enjoy just listening to them play. And I think sometimes the students, you know, they think, oh, we just holding them in practice for however long we held them, and we done made them watch this show and all this stuff, and we just saying stuff to make them feel good. But nah, we really do enjoy listening to them play. And this next clip, I think, is going to show how much we enjoy listening to the band play.
Oh, y'all finna be turned. I can feel it. Man, my dog is like circling in the chair.
Tunes. A student was working for he was doing like an internship for one music group, and he was like, you know, the artist was gonna give us a couple of tunes to look through and everything. And the artist, this was one of the ones that the artist sent us. So he came to the school and spoke to the students and everything. It was real neat for them to be able to meet him and everything.
Yeah. You folks down front, Dr. Little.
That's why I had to call and make sure everything was good. But you know, like I said, there's plenty of clips where you know you could just see us bobbing and stuff and foot tapping and everything. Because honestly, it's a blessing to be, you know, like when you started in arranging. I'm sure everybody's probably got a similar story. It was a hobby. It was something cool, something fun to do. And you know, the privilege, the blessing, the honor of being able to make that your profession at this point. and you know, to bit, just sit there every day and do what you love for and to see the students react to it, it's you know, it's a pretty big deal.
It really is.
All right, I got a quick. I'm sorry. Go ahead, Larry.
Oh no, I was just responding. Saying I wouldn't trade that. Like that is, you know, very true. You got to wake up and do what you want to do. Because everybody can't. You know, that's not a reality for everybody.
Yeah.
And that's to having that reality, man. Shoot, I don't take that for granted, man. And then to be a part of these legacies that we're a part of, you know, just like with your band, same with mine, we can trace back so far the people and the places, the things that these programs have done, but it's affected the culture and the world, shoot.
And it connects to folks so hard, man. We got a guy that comes out whenever we do alumni band. He's got a class of 60 something on his sousaphone. Like it runs deep, you know.
Yeah.
I got a question. Y'all came in through Instagram. Brian Evans asks, I guess for both of you, when you're writing your arrangements, what do you think about in terms of which instruments have the melody and who gets the chords? I'll start with you, Mr. Johnson. Larry, I need your song for next round, Larry.
Okay. Well, first off, like with brass instruments, for instance, my biggest, I guess, first guiding light is you consider which instruments are conical and cylindrical. So you look at the artist, and basically, if the artist has a more a brighter timbre to his or her voice, you're going to want to go with the conical instruments because you're going to get that type of timbre from that instrument. If it's a more mellow, relaxed thing, you might want to look at the cylindrical instruments because they're going to give you a warmer tone. Conical being your trumpets, your trombones, cylindrical being your baritones and horns and things like that. And just kind of, I try my hardest to listen to the tune to nauseam almost, because to me, it's a lot easier to arrange out of my head versus having to press the play button and rewind and fast forward. So I try to memorize as much of the tune as I can and get the roadmap together. And from that point, sometimes I'll put the chords on, split them between the woodwinds, the mellophones, and baritones if I want a more abrasive melody, so I have room for the trombones to do it. But it's not really a safe place to ask where to start. It's just, you know, learn the song, internalize it. You got two ears and one mouth. Listen more than you speak. And I guess in this light, listen more than you're trying to scribble on a piece of paper. And that way you can make more sense musically out of things before you start even whatever your notation software is going to be.
And I'll kind of jump off of what you said. For me, I try to create the essence of what I'm hearing, even down to like the inflections. So I try to match the voice, and you said conical and cylindrical, when you spoke about that, that really is where, that's almost the essence of what I'm thinking too, trying to match the texture of the voice in the song, especially if somebody's singing, get it as close as possible to get the feel for what you actually hear on the track. I'm in my arranging style, personally, a lot of what I do, I want it to sound a lot like the song. We all have our own different styles. You know, you have some who put more of themselves into the arrangement, and you know, we'll sacrifice some, which is fine. You know, that's what makes us all who we are. But I like it to feel like the song as much as possible. So yeah, I'll definitely try to pair the instrument or the instrument pairings themselves to match the voice almost as close as I can.
That's an interesting point, real quick. So you have the option of either writing, like you said, just to capture the song in itself, or what a lot of arrangers seem like they do, they'll add their trademark sound to it, you know. So is it possible to do both, though?
I think absolutely. And I've heard some of the other arrangers from the other parts of the series kind of touching on this as well. But if you look at it, like, for instance, if you looked at an X-ray of a human skeleton, if you look at that X-ray of a human skeleton, you can see that it's a human skeleton. It should be a skull around here somewhere, some ribs around here, some arms around here. So you can easily tell. You're looking at a skeleton. You can't tell if this person has blue eyes or short hair, long hair, you know, if they're large or small, you know, all these. You can't tell those things. That's what makes it an individual. But the skeleton is what it was, what the song is itself. Now, all of the other things, the personal touches, I think that's where the arranger gets the chance to go in and add his or her own style onto it. And but again, that skeleton, and I'm saying that because I'm looking at folks in our band on here too. I want to make sure that I stress that. You know, it's always important to make sure that you can tell what the song is and you don't sacrifice the integrity of the original piece, basically.
Okay.
You explain that like a professor, man.
Right, that was good.
I get by every once in a while. Thank you.
All right, y'all want to get into the next round? It's on you, Larry. Let's go. I got you up right now.
Oh, bet. This one, so as a band director, too, real quick, y'all, anybody who's going to be a band director, especially with a marching band, with shows, you have time restraints. You can't go out there and do a 40-minute show just because you feel like it. So with this one, when we did this ballad, and I love doing ballads, we did this one. Actually, time ended up being a consideration before actually pinning this all the way out. And it ended up working perfectly with the amount we had, but it was shortened because of the show and just making sure we're in the restraints of the time.
You know, I don't think people understand how difficult that is to do when you listen to a piece of music and you got so much that's going on in your head, and you put the, you know, with the tune, you did a really, really good job of taking the essence of the song and sounding like getting what you want in there. And because I know the song is much longer than whatever the clip was, and that's tough, man. And I always say this to folks as well. Contrast is what makes music interesting. When you get to the point where you're listening to a piece of music and it's doing it, like if you know, even if you're cranking up and a piece of music is just screaming at you for 30 minutes, you tend to kind of zone out and things like that. Like that spot where you got out of the chorus and jumped to the woodwinds real quiet like that. That contrast is like, oh shoot, you know, like let me pay attention all over again, because that contrast is always going to be what makes music interesting.
It is for being still.
Absolutely. That's a perfect perfect explanation for it.
All right. Hey, fellas, we got the next song up. This is Mr. Johnson right here. Let's get into it.
All right. So you had a trombone melody. I'm going to go ahead and throw one back in the mix, too. Thank you. Appreciate it, man.
In particular, that trombone break.
Oh, thanks, man. A lot of those ending tuba notes, I'm not gonna lie, it's just because we have a bunch of tubas. just kind of that bam right on the end of it, just be done with it. You know, kind of put that nail in the coffin. And again, it's just about using what you have. You know, highlighting the students that you get and working through it. The tune itself. Another one of those where you just kind of, I think I was at Kroger and heard it come on at the grocery store. It is one of those things that was kind of in the back of your brain, but like, hey, you know that Sade be singing, man.
Man,
yeah, I got a good question that came in. This is actually from Derek Wright. He was on the show last week. He arranges for Norfolk State. Okay. He asks, make sure I get the question right. One second here. What advice would you give arrangers who are considering moving up from high school to higher education?
You want to go first?
Sure, I can. I mean, right out the gate, it kind of goes back to something that we talked about a minute ago, and that's like writing for the band that you have. You know, you definitely want to be in tune with, the band that you're writing for. That's going to be very important coming from high school to going to a college. You know, in most cases, you're going to be dealing with a band that's now larger in size. The playing level is now going to go to a different place because you have experience. You know, some people might have 5 years more experience than your high school senior or freshman playing. So you now have all those things to look at when it comes to arranging at the next level. And another important key that I think you have to do is be very conscious of the band's image and their style, and really digging into some of the history of the band and the band's sound, because that stuff y'all know those things are like very important to us. We hold those in high regard. You know, you want to be able to look back in 20 years and still have that characteristic sound that your organization is known for. Like right now, listening to TSU and Jackson, we sound different. Both bands sound great, but it's different. And those are things that you want to be able to capture while at the same time you still have your own influence on it. But being able to capture all those things, being able to move from high school to the college level, right?
I take it from the standpoint, when I graduated in 2005, around 2004, that winter, when I'm getting ready to go student teaching and everything, I think every music major goes through this point where they start thinking about the stuff they're going to say when students do this in a room, and they're going to think about, you know, how they're going to talk to the principal and get 400 new band. You know, you used to just start running all that stuff through your head. And I was absolutely anti-middle school. I did not want to touch a middle school band room when I left Jackson State. So yeah. I found a job. I taught high school. And actually, my mom took sick, so I ended up having to move to Memphis. And my little brother was goofing off in his classroom and took a picture of him doing something stupid. And I was like, wait, hold on. That band room looks real nice. Send me a bigger picture. Go ahead, pass by. So I ended up applying for that job because the band room was nice. And but this is the crazy part. As much as I never wanted to teach middle school, I went in that room and I started teaching middle school in 2008 and absolutely loved it. Now, with that, I had to go down to zero because I had to teach these students how to play from nothing. And with that, learning exactly how to teach people on the instruments and what each instrument is supposed to do, how you develop on it. I met another band director out there who, you know, he had a whole bunch of really, really good students making the honor bands and stuff. And I was like, how you doing this? And he said he learned the honor band music on every instrument. And I was like, I don't know if I got the patience for all of that, but I will learn a couple of scales on each one. So I did that. And I was the worst flute player on the planet in methods class. But when it came to being in front of those kids, let me tell you something, middle school kids will rib you, Joan you, check you down if you miss a note now. So I had to make sure if I'm demonstrating on that flute, I got to make sure my notes right. I got, if I'm doing it on the clarinet, got to make sure my notes right. I was fine on brass, but those woodwinds gave me the blues. And really getting there, learning those scales, learning how the instrument works was what helped me as an arranger. That, to me, there's a line between when I learned actually what those instruments are supposed to do, what fingerings work well, what slide positions work well, and all that kind of stuff. And then you keep that in mind when you arrange. And again, brushing with the grain. When you work along the line of what your instrument is supposed to do, your music sounds better. So knowing those rules and, you know, learn the rules before you try to break them. So, you know, learn the rules before you try to break them of arranging so you can kind of develop that skill.
Okay.
Yeah, bro, I'm going to be real quick about it. But so I used to teach elementary school music early in my career as well. And it just hit me when you were talking about making sure that you were tight on those instruments so you don't get checked. Mm-hmm. I had a strings class. Now, and for all the music majors, anybody who's supposed to be a band director, you can't guarantee where you'll be coming out of school. Like, you don't know. And especially when the pockets hit. And
that's it.
You need to eat. You know, you need somewhere to stay. So you got to take the job that comes. Mm-hmm. And anyway, I'm very thankful for all my, you know, every experience that I've had. But I had to teach strings, man. And I used to get to just kind of have a philosophy to stay 2 weeks ahead. So I'd be up there creaking and slawing it up. But I was to the point where I could properly teach the students how to play. You know, if I can give you a good start at that age, you know, if I can start you off right, then I've done my job. And I definitely feel you on that, 'cause that experience. Mm-hmm. That's,
I'm going to go ahead and put a bullet point in something you said, just in case there are any music majors out there. Learn how to play the instrument that you are teaching to the students you're teaching it to. And not only that, you don't have to be a virtuoso on it, but learn the ins and outs of it enough to make a characteristic sound. And, you know, every once in a while, you have to, you know, in band director mode, you got to be frustrated enough to just go over there and yank somebody's trumpet out of their hand, put your mouthpiece in, and just start going to town. And, you know, like middle school, especially, those kids are so dramatic. Mr. Johnson, my trumpet doesn't work. And then I get the horn and play a chromatic scale. I ain't doing too much. But play the dollar chromatic scale real fast and everybody class, ooh, you know. Just showing the students how things work. And, you know, like how to problem solve and stuff like that on the instrument from the teacher's perspective is super duper important. You know, being a model of what the instrument should sound like is always super duper helpful. And stay, like you said, 2 weeks ahead, as many weeks as you can. You know, you don't ever want to pick up the horn or the violin, the viola, whatever you end up teaching, and scratch on that bad boy, because they'll forget what you said as far as anything about teaching a lot of stuff, but they'll never forget that bad note.
I'm glad I delivered from that.
Yeah. All right, I think we left off with Mr. Johnson. I think we back on you, Mr. Jenkins.
Yep. All right, we about to rock a song that wasn't necessarily on the radio. This is something I just thought was bumping. Like, I heard it on YouTube one day, and literally it was just like, oh. Like, so BJ is a Chicago kid. I think he's a dope artist, real soulful. BJ the Chicago Kid, Offset.
All right, let's get it. Here we go.
Thank you.
I think I'm gonna go ahead and throw B flat minor in that same basket with D minor.
It is.
It's just one of those days where people get all kind of good stuff going on.
No question. You mentioned the two of the last notes.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. That's
it. B flat is just too open.
Smacking on them every single time. All right. I got the next tune ready.
All right. Go ahead and introduce us to it, Mr. Johnson. I'm about to pull it up now.
Okay. This. Fast notes. That's what's going on here. So actually, I'd spoken to Mr. Taylor about we were talking a while ago, and he was like, yeah. And I think people who know him, you got to know his demeanor and the way he speaks and everything. You really never know. There's a 99% chance Mr. Taylor's being sarcastic every time he's talking. You really, you know, you have to really watch and wait for that next sentence sometimes to tell him, you know, see if he's joking with you. But that was the way he described it. He's like, hey, I need some fast notes. I was like, okay. And listen to some tunes and try to make it work off of that. And I'm a big fan of the artist as well, too. So I've listened to a bunch of his tunes as well. So
yeah.
Here we go.
Shout out Mr. Taylor, man.
Yeah. Great guy. I think you might have to check the timestamp on that. Oh, yeah.
Like that, bro.
Much appreciated. It took me a minute. You know, growing up in New Orleans, I don't even know what terrible, probably slightly racist names we had for quads and quints and things like that. Because we just didn't see a whole lot of them around unless we played a school from like a neighboring parish that was, you know, like where the school is the same name as the city or whatever it's in. But when I got to Jackson State and like heard that pocket being filled in by all of the quints and stuff like that, and really just the drum section in general, man, those folks do good work up there at the top of the band room. But it took me a minute to get used to those quints and quads and stuff. And then when I went back home and they weren't there, it was I felt, you know, like something was missing.
I actually understand that completely because we didn't have them at TSU.
Okay,
man, we had a. Yeah, it's the basic setup. We didn't have points or quarters back then either. So, yeah,
Like if somebody yanked them out of the band, now you'd be like, yeah, something's missing. Yeah, something's missing. Yeah. Those percussive parts.
Yep.
Hey, real quick, fellas, quick question. Came in from CF Toya. She's asking, well, she pretty much asks about, you know, influences that kind of got you into arrangement. So that's a good way to phrase it. So what are some of your inspirations, some of your mentors, and who got you behind, you know, on that paper and pen?
I can start this one. First person I already mentioned once, Mario said this, and I'm going to echo this as well, probably one of the most underrated in the game, and not underrated as far as talent. He's just so quiet. He's he'll be to himself a little bit. Just a quiet guy, real cool, real chill. But Pop Sexton at TSU is amazing, and he's really cultivated our sound. You know, for most of our lives, like the age range that we're in, probably when we got into bands. But if you listen to TSU, you're hearing Prof Sexton before him, Prof Kirk. But you're hearing that Prop Sexton sound. So he's very influential in the game, even if you don't say his name enough. I want to make sure to shout him out. So he's a big influence. Really taught me a lot about colors. I mentioned that earlier in the show. Being able to pair certain voices together to get a certain timbre, get a certain sound, to give off a certain feeling. His orchestration class, I will say this, is still to this day, is the most just important class I've ever taken in regards to arranging. So he's definitely there, and I got three more. Prof Kelvin Washington, he's a band director at Howard University. Definitely learned a whole lot from him during my time there. Especially, like, he's one of the people who breaks the monotony in an arrangement. He likes to go on those off beats, so he'll hit you on two. Shout out to Prof Wash, shout out to everybody at HU. Paul Adams. So I grew up in VA, grew up 15 minutes away from Norfolk State. So I was probably at every home game from, you know, my sophomore year in high school until I graduated. And Paul Adams, I just think he's amazing. The word motif comes to mind, how he always brings that motif back from the Behold song into the endings and the trills. I really just like what he thinks. And his ear is crazy. If you ever have a chance to be around him, well, at this point, he's retired, but man, his ear is just insane. So he's there. And then last person is my man, Prof Sergeant at FAM. I'm a big ballad guy. Like, love to write ballads. Trying my best not to play like a whole bunch of them back to back because I just enjoy them. But his voicing, the way he manipulates dynamics, and I'm a big endings guy, and his endings on songs always bring that my exposure to it. So those four for me are the ones who just really jump out as far as my influences.
It's funny you mentioned Mr. Adams. For those who don't know, Mr. Adams is a trombone player, and Mr. Adams was the person that auditioned me when I went to Jackson State, and I was, and crazy enough, my office is his former office where I auditioned. But how stuff just kind of reverts back. But there was a trombone player in there auditioning right before I was supposed to go in, so I was standing outside his door, and you know, if you know Mr. Adams, he don't really care about candor and all that kind of stuff. So he was ripping this trombone player, a new one, right before my audition. I don't think I'd ever been that nervous about it. And if you know Mr. Adams, you know, he's just like, well, you know, your tone quality was this, and you know, basically you're terrible at everything that you're doing. So, you know, he's just so effortlessly butchering this trombone player. And I was like, oh my goodness. And I'm about to go in here and play this doggone French horn, and I don't even know if it works. But, you know, past that, speaking to Mr. Adams musically is probably, you know, those people that have the opportunity to do it, they really need to talk to him. on a just have a musical conversation with Mr. Adams. You know, a flyer fly past him. He's like, yeah, you know, this freaking E flat fly is working on my. Yes. You know, that's just kind of how he is, man. And I, just everything that he spews out of his mouth is going to have something that you can pull musically and make something out of it. And it's just, it's absolutely amazing talking to him and listening to his style. You know, he was at Norfolk for a while. He was at Jackson State, and you had Norfolk, Jackson State playing with the same arranger sounding completely different. For him to be able to be that versatile in his styling, where Norfolk just did not sound like Jackson State, even if they were playing, you know, one of the arrangements that they might have used at Jackson State, you know, he's putting extra stuff on the end to make it, it's insane. Mr. Adams, most definitely. I would say Mr. Taylor, you know, he had a big influence on a lot of the sound that Jackson State had when the Motown band around that area. Mr. Holden around Jackson State as well. Dr. Thomas, just that whole crew. Dr. Magruder was the arranger on staff when I was there. And, you know, listening to him and trying to work my style. Anytime we had to, if we tried to get an arrangement played, which was pretty tough, we had to go through him. And, you know, he had a very low key personality as well. You know, basically, you know, it's just ball it up, start it over, man. you know, just it just learning, you know, you don't take it as an L. You don't take it as a offense. Like, these people, you need to respect the time, you know, the hours that they've put into this thing. And, you know, these are people who were, you know, they were on staff paper with a pencil. They weren't sitting up there using Sibelius and Finale and MuseScore and Note Flight and all these other kind of things. So, you know, these are people who almost all of them, well, not almost all of them, every last one of them are ridiculous musicians. So, you know, they can pull this stuff out and jot it down on paper. It's just, it's awesome to see them in practice, and it's awesome to sit there and have conversations. I think, I think on some scale, it would be really arrogant of all of us, any HBCU band director, to say that all of them haven't influenced us in some kind of way.
For sure.
We've taken something from everybody and kind of honed it into what we do in our own practices. You know, that's the, again, the beauty of that HBCU thing is we're definitely an ecosystem. We're not islands. And we, you know, being exposed, you're from Virginia, you got the Howard, the Hampton and the Norfolks and all that stuff in that area. You know, down here in the South, you got Jackson State. Well, it's three HBCUs in Mississippi with fairly large band programs, a bunch in Alabama, a bunch in Louisiana. So there's no way that nobody is just on this isolation. Well, yeah, I only listen to Jackson State band directors. You a lie. That's a trash comment for you to make. You know, we're in an ecosystem, and, you know, sometimes we got to put our little egos and our trash talk aside. We're listening to each other. Absolutely. You know, trying to stay current and stay, you know, trying to learn. Iron sharp as iron, man.
That's it. And that's important to do. Like, the fact that you even said that, like, it's so many good bands in our culture. We all bring something to the table. You know, and I'm glad that the students that are on and just people who might not be as familiar that are on can hear a conversation like this, because for real, it's a community.
Absolutely. It really is. And, you know, I was telling you earlier, you know, I taught middle school. So, you know, these gray hairs that they originated, you know, they're over there marching in TSU's band now. I got some marching with me at Jackson State. I got a couple marching at Southern. You know, I and not only that, I went to high school with one of Southern's directors, and man, we were the absolute worst of band heads. I see my old roommate in the chat somewhere. I know for a fact when he was in high school, me and the one of the band directors at Southern, we harassed everybody in McMaine to make sure to try to get people to join the band. So, you know, we're all connected in some kind of way. You know, a bunch of my friends from McMaine, a couple of them marched at TSU probably around your time when you were there as well. So we all know each other. Memphis is a big hub. You know, these kids know each other. And, you know, realizing, again, yeah, the trash talk is cool. It's fine. It's dandy. It's wonderful. It's funny. Right. The meme squad at Jackson State is unlike any other, man. They meme so quick, it makes my head spin sometimes. But, you know, again, they know people at TSU and Southern and all these other places. And not only that, you know, I worked in MCS with Mario Warren and Newsom and And, you know, all these folks, we had a chance to sit down and chew the fat. Like, we really, you know, it's an ecosystem. It's probably less than 1 degree of separation.
I wanted to hold off, fellas, on making this announcement. But since we know it's a good segue, and you guys mentioned some living legends, you know, people who definitely influenced you. First of all, I want to thank y'all for being on the show, man. Everybody who's been on the show so far. I had a chance to speak to two of the living legends that you mentioned. I won't name any names. I ain't going to let the whole cat out of the bag yet. But I will say that both have come to the agreement that they would like to be on the Arrangers Battle. Yes. I won't name names yet. What I want y'all to do is just subscribe to the channel and follow us on Meet Me on the 50 on Instagram. But two of the people named during this segment right here of these living legends will be on the show battling each other on Meet Me on the 50, man. Now, it's crazy to think about it. So I don't want to, you know, we're going to continue this show. It's back on you, Larry. But people, if you're watching this, you don't want to miss that show. Yeah. It's going to be coming up very, very soon. Very soon.
That's going to be something crazy. And in solidarity, I saw two of my students pop up in the, well, former students pop up, some TSU, some aristocrats currently. Sure. I see them over there.
Mm-mm. All right, Larry, it's back on you, man. I think I got your song up. Let's go.
Let's get it. I'm back on the battle wave. I told you I love it.
Oh my. Enjoy.
See, you go put the band and the crowd on me. I got you. Okay. I got the next clip ready. Let's do it.
All right, I'm about to pull it up. Go ahead and bring us into it, bro.
I ain't got nothing to say. Just press play. That's all I can do. All right,
give me 10 seconds. 10 seconds. Let's go.
It's not a Corona cough. I inhaled a little too quick. Well, yeah, I guess everybody gets nervous these days. I'm staying in the house. Staying in the house.
It's not a Corona cough. Mm.
Hey,
Yes, sir.
I appreciate it. You know, I've said that everything is practice for something. You know, it's about being patient and waiting your turn sometime. And I'd actually interviewed for the job previously and had a chance to, when you do the interview and everything, you got to come down and present something to the band. And that was the tune that I'd actually had a chance to work out with the band on that first audition. On the first interview, rather. So, you know, it's about sometimes everything doesn't pan out like you want it, but or like I know for a fact, again, everything's practice or something. I ended up moving and teaching middle school out in Florida, real, real competitive district, a lot of big high school, middle school bands, and I ended up learning a whole lot out there. And now, you know, you get older, you look back, and it's like, man. I needed that experience. I needed to learn the things that I caught at that point. So, you know, I just kind of wanted to throw that little message of persistence in there for folks too.
Facts. Put you right in place where you need to be.
Hey, quick question came in from Shan B. That Guy. I know you said the number of tubas give you freedom to make some nice bass lines, but do you ever feel limited with what you can do with an arrangement based on a certain section?
I would, if I could take a word out of that, I would take limited out. And I think that instead of saying limiting yourself or something, it's about rethinking things. For instance, if there's a passage, you may want to think about breaking the passage up between certain sections or something like that. Not necessarily giving up on your good idea. And look, sometimes you will walk into the front of the band room and we're fortunate enough to put everybody on digital music at this point and make people look at a drive based music system. Mm-hmm. It's been a couple of times I've played something and I was like, okay. And then I go upstairs and immediately pull it out the folder and have to rethink some things and put it back in because some things don't work. So it's not necessarily about limiting. But it, being smart definitely helps. You know, if you rethinking things, being persistent about, I really like this idea. How can I work it out? You know, I tell that to the section leaders, be consistent in your persistent demand of quality. And sometimes you just need to sit there and, you know, make some people sweat and spend about 30 minutes working on them full measures. Other times you can, I think after you deal with your band for a minute, you know, okay, yeah, this not gonna work, or this might work. And sometimes, well, I'll try this. So don't limit yourself. Just be smart about it. And it kind of like, even if you're a classroom teacher, you know, you got different types of learners in the room. Sometimes you got to say it for the auditory learners. You got to say it for the visual. You got to draw it for the visual learners. You got to dance for the kinesthetic learners and all that kind of stuff. So just kind of making sure that you think of a different angle sometimes to get your idea across, I think is helpful.
All right. Okay, cool. Let's get into it, man. This is Larry Jenkins. I don't even know what round we on, y'all, but we going. What's going on, Larry?
With this one, too, this is actually the only time that I can think of that I've ever been a part of, like, a collab on one chart. So this one was Prof Sexton and myself. It's almost like I did certain sections. And he did a couple sections, and then bang. I can't remember why that was the case. There was a reason, but it was one of those things where we collabed. And I want to make sure to put this one on because it's almost in a sense like we blended our styles, which are both different and similar at the same time. Doesn't make any sense. But we blended our styles into one thing. I think it's important to play this one because we had that talk about influences. And just listen and see if you can, I guess, tell the difference between me and him.
It's one of those days I was following Whitehaven. Right.
Thank you.
Okay, I hear you. Now, I'll ask you this. When collaborating with another arranger, what are some of the things that you feel like you face there? I'll say this. In the instance of this particular collaboration, you know, you're actually collaborating with somebody that you mentioned as one of your mentors. So that's probably pretty easy. But well, not necessarily. I'm not going to just go ahead and blanket call it easy. But yeah. So, I mean, like, how did that work out for you? How'd y'all approach that?
It was not as difficult as it seemed. Again, it was the first time I can remember ever doing it. I mean, I've sat down with people and have worked on stuff, you know, just like you have. I sit down with a student or a friend, like, oh, well, we do this, such and such, such. But this was a little bit different because it was actually like, you know, he did this section of the piece. And let's say like the A section of the piece. Okay. I did the intro. He did the A section. And it's like, oh, how are we going to blend this A section going to this B section? Oh, let's do X, Y, Z, bang. And then next thing you know, we're into the B section. I knock out the B section. So it was one of those things where it was actually quite simple, not difficult really at all, just different. The first time that's ever been the case for me, but it came out so well. Definitely.
So y'all collaborated basically section by section.
Yeah, that's how
I
went.
That's neat. Cause that I mean, like joining a house together and adding addition on. That's pretty cool.
Yeah,
so I just sent the next clip in, and not necessarily it wasn't a collab, but every once in a while, what I'll try to do is like I listen to the music that the band has played, that Dr. Little's played, has arranged and stuff like that. And I try to like call back to some phrases and things that he did. So he played, you know, we played Kill Shot in 18, and then we played this next tune, and there's like a little section in there. It's barely like four. I think it's four counts. Matter of fact, it might be 48 counts where I tried to kind of incorporate just kind of like that brand continuity or whatever to, you know, hey, you know, call back and kind of keep us consistent and everything.
the Bruno. Yeah.
A
certain sound, man.
It's just the perfect combination of old and new, man. I think he does a phenomenal job with that.
Thanks.
Hey, question came in, Mr. Johnson. This is from Patrick Petaway 2000. All right, Okay. He asks, how do you feel? This can really be applied to both of you. How do you feel about student arrangers? And I'm going to remix the second part. What was your very first song written as a student arranger?
Okay, so that's a loaded question because that's Pat. We both joined a band the same year. Mm-hmm. First tune I got out was the Thong song, and it was terrible. you know, just looking back at it, it was a representation of the song, but there's so much that I feel like I probably would have done differently. We were fortunate enough to be kind of in the boom around that time where we had a lot of heavy student leadership. We had some great student arrangers. We had some strong musicians and things like that. And, you know, we were just afforded just because of that time where it was. And my last year in the band, it was really a lot of student influence and a lot of fortunate opportunities for us to be able to work with the band hands on, because the staff was really working on drills and things like that and kind of fine tuning the full picture. And, you know, we just needed dance routine music. So we were fortunate enough to get a chance, you know, and things like that. With student arrangers, I'm pro student arrangers, but I need student arrangers to realize, number one, you've got to study and put in the time to listen to the band and learn it. And I don't want to say learn it to the point where you're diluting who you are in the music, but learning to the point where you can maintain what the band is gonna, the characteristic sound of the ensemble, and still add yourself into it. And right now, and no diss, no shade, I guess that's what people are gonna say. Right now we're in a phase where a lot of students can tend to rely on the software itself. And the software is great. But you got to realize that the software is not going to sound like the band. And sometimes even the stuff you hear in the song is not going to sound the same in the software and all this other kind of stuff. So it's about knowing what it is before you even sit down, because that computer can be very deceiving. And, you know, sometimes people can play rhythms in and it'll have, you know, 16 tied 16 notes instead of a quarter note and all kind of this thing. So learning like the actual the method of quantizing and using the rhythms properly, knowing, and I preach this to our student arrangers a whole lot. People, especially teaching middle school, people develop a certain rhythmic vocabulary. So every last one of us here was in the band. Shout out to the fellow mellophone player. You know that you're going to see a 16th note, an eighth note, and a 16th note. You know what that rhythm sounds like because you know it from your middle school Ed Sweater page 43 rhythm and all that kind of stuff. So we learn these things and we learn rhythmic vocabularies and just learning how to actually put that stuff on paper so that the reader can easily pull it off of the page is super important, because your message is not going to get across from somebody if they can't read it. If you got a dotted 64th on the page, I mean, shoot, most advanced musicians are going to be like, what? So, you know, it's about making it, especially in this, you know, we all have time constraints on practice. We have, you know, shows that need to come out Saturday. We got music that needs to be played Saturday, all these other kind of things. If you can't put it down on paper and write it down without that, if your lights went out and you had a candle, a pencil, and a piece of staff paper, if you can't get that music out, rethink some stuff. Go back, learn how to do it, number one. And number two, make your music as easy for the reader as possible. That way your message gets across and you can, it just makes more sense. It just from a time standpoint, just being efficient in practice. If I got to teach you a rhythm and you could have used an easier one, you know, why are we doing this at some point?
Gotcha. How about you, Mr. Jenkins?
Man, you kind of nailed it. I'll start with my first arrangement at TSU. I mean, I was writing in high school, too. I'm sure you were too. My first TSU arrangement, though, was Number One by Pharrell and Kanye West. And we actually did a downfield drill to that at Southern Heritage Classic in 2006. That was the year after you graduated. But 2006, we did a downfield drill. I've been bugging Prof Texan that summer, just like sending music. And you know, he just finally bit and gave in. So it gave me a lot of pointers and really taught me a lot, even in that process doing that one. But, you know, because of that, it turned out really well. We were able to rock that day. But didn't really do too much more. There were a couple more Rangers that were in school with me that are out there doing it now. Shout out to Brian Knowles and Miles and Devonon. He's at Mississippi Valley. But, I think all of us were, you know, in that learning process back then and just really getting our feet wet with a college band. So, I mean, it was definitely dope. I'm with you. I'm pro student arranger. I know for my own personal opinion, I like them to go through that prop sex and gauntlet a little bit too, though, just because it makes you think so much. I remember going up with an arrangement and being told, well, why did you do that? And I had no answer. It was just a simple question. Why?
And hey, that's a strong question. But check this out. I'm going to say this about that why. And I try to ask students that as well. And I tell either you're going to explain it and tell me why you did it, or you're going to teach me something and justify why you did it. So at that point, I'm not asking you why to be a jerk. I'm asking you for the standpoint of what was the basis of you doing this, or how can I learn from what you're doing? But I tell you what, I understand that it's an intimidating question because you got to follow through with that bad boy.
And you hear it. And then on the spot too, it's just like, I really don't even know. I mean, in the mind is making sense, but it just makes it more cerebral. Like, you know, you're really thinking about why you're doing it. Everything matters, from, you know, the top of the score down to the bottom. Every single thing you put up here matters. There's no fluff. And, you know, that mindset really helped me out a whole lot, you know, in the arranging game. Thinking about really thinking through what I was doing, even if it sounds good, because you mentioned the programs. I call some of the folks again, no shade, none of that. But you got like these just finale warriors and civilians where you go in on there. But if you put it in front of an ensemble, it comes out totally different.
And it's always that human element, man. As great as these software, man, we got this VST for Sibelius, and Dr. Lynn and I use it. It's called No Performer. It sounds like you're sitting dead in front of somebody playing an instrument, but that thing will be just as deceptive with some of the things that you're doing on page. If you know, we talked earlier, if you know what the instrument is supposed to do, how to function on it, you know, that like those finale warriors and Sibelius warriors and stuff like that clears that whole argument. If you know what the instrument can actually do, I fully agree with that.
Yes.
All right. Hey, Jess, it's back on you, Larry.
Man, I'm coming through now.
Okay.
My bad, Bri. I should be on the way. Man, this is dope. I don't even know what round we're on. We've just been vibing. It's pretty cool, man.
Absolutely, man.
And the crazy thing is, for the folks out there listening, we met yesterday. I don't know how. Because really, I feel like any band that we play, I know, you know, folks from. I guess I just didn't know everybody. So, you know, it's good to be connected too. I'm just tripping that it's now, it wasn't before.
Well, I'll say this: it's probably because I'm a bit of a hermit, and I think I probably got about 6 or 7 texts with the picture of the flyer. Asking if this was real, because I don't think people thought I would actually talk. So, you know, it's cool to actually come out on this forum and be able to talk to, especially, you know, the students and other directors, you know, the hosts and all these kind of things, so that, you know, people can see that the camaraderie. And not only that, we can actually talk to these younger aspiring arrangers and teachers and things, and hopefully, you know, throw something out there that's usable.
For sure. All right, let me speak on this one real quick. This is funny. You already see who both is in the title. was it you that wrote this?
I didn't do that one.
So, anyways, this for me, I love the fact that we played this one, because it ended up becoming like a trend. I mean, I know y'all probably picking it was like, man, we about to troll them boys. Like, but it was it definitely became a trend. Like high schools, it's like five colleges to play, and we started playing this in 2015. So this is one that's kind of special to me, and I love looking at the comments between the between us and y'all in particular. Because you can kind of just get both sides of, oh, I like this because they play this one. I like this about this, but this about this. I thought it was pretty dope. So, anyways, here's one of the ones that became a classic.
Hey, real quick, man. I see y'all see Killer Kev on the screen right here, man. I want to really quickly shout out Kev, man. He is leading the pack. Look, 2019, my brother, man, he has, I want to say, four videos that's reached over 2 million views, man. So,
that's
Kev.
Awesome.
You out there putting in work. If you watching the show, man, congratulations on that. Keep working, bro. It's just like the sky's the limit, man. All right, here we go.
Let's go with the. We're gonna wake folks up again. All right, let's go ahead on with that next clip.
All right, give you about 15 seconds. Let me pull it up.
I got you.
All right.
Well, while you taking that time, you know, you mentioned Killer Kev. Quite honestly, not just him. And I don't want to get into names because I know I'm gonna mess somebody up and forget somebody. But the ones that I can think of offhand, you know, the Smash Times and the Showtimes and Marvin Price, of course, Meet Me on the 50, Killer Kev, just all of you folks that take your time and resources to cover HBCU bands, man, we see y'all everywhere. And I know that's not easy. I know that's taxing. We appreciate y'all giving us that coverage and working for us to make sure that what we're doing and our students especially get highlighted and seen. So we appreciate that.
Salute.
No doubt. Thank you, sir. Appreciate that. All right, here we go. Clip is up. This is Mr. Johnson.
Oh, man, you digging it. Oh, man.
Oh, man. Cut off on me.
Hold on, before I play it, hey, Mr. Johnson, is that the right location?
That's the right one.
That's it? All right, let's go.
We'll be right back.
I got to set that one up. When I was in high school, there was this this girl that was on the majorette squad, and I'm perfectly certain that nowhere in America is there a bigger boys to men fan. Man, she used to be in the hallway with her batons, twirling batons, singing this song in particular. And when we got a new band director, Mr. Washington, I border on crediting, and he'll probably look at me crazy if I say this, but Mr. Brian Washington, one of my high school band directors, is GOAT is not enough to describe this man. You know, he treated us all like his kids. He brought us up to Jackson to audition. You know, Mr. Washington, you know, if you ever catch this clip, thank you for allowing me to arrange in high school and for just being Mr. Washington in high school. And I see a couple of my classmates on there. They know, he's just an amazing guy. When he came in, this is one of the tunes that he played along with us, and She Lost Her Mind. It always kind of stuck with me, and just kind of fond memories of the tune.
Oh, that's dope. And I remember hearing this. That's when you pulled back that phone. I'm like, oh wow! I didn't know that you did. Like, I've been hearing that for years. So, kudos, man. And I want to also speak on high school director real quick too. I'd shout out my high school director Thomas Thurgood for the same thing, giving me a platform to actually grow. You know, let me arrange. I was a sophomore in high school when he let me start arranging, and it just sparked the interest. Like, I would call folks, and shout out to some of my friends from high school who put up with me. And I was calling them on Saturday morning, playing Fnatic clips over the phone.
That's it, man. That's it.
It was obnoxious. But, yeah, man, I really appreciate my high school band director, too. And I'm glad you took the time to shout that out, because, that means a lot. They really put a lot into us as far as the trajectory of our careers, man. So, shout out to Thomas Thurgood, too.
Yeah, it's to that point where, like, quite honestly, you know, every time, and I still talk to Mr. Washington fairly regularly now. You know, I always tell him, like, man, I'm hoping I got some of the influence that you had on me. Just if I could pass on a little bit of it. I mean, I see a couple of classmates. I see some younger folks that were in the band with me as well, but were in the band with me at Jackson State and McMahon. Man, he was just an amazing guy. Well, he is just an amazing guy. And, he keeps track of us and just always supported, man. Those high school band directors that build these folks. We appreciate y'all.
Man, facts.
Before we get into this next song right here, I want y'all to know, man, this is the second to last round, man. So this has been, we've been running about 2 hours, fellas. We've been going at it. so if you drop some flames in the comments, y'all, let these brothers know, man. Y'all appreciate what they're doing for us this evening right here. All right, it's back on you, Mr. Jenkins. Let's go.
Man, I got to give you a timestamp real quick. If you can go to like 30 seconds, because I don't want to have everybody wait that 30 to get there. But this goes we're back on the neo soul vibe on my end. But what is important about this one for the arrangers, and kind of something that we talked about a little bit earlier, is really just getting the timbre, you know, matching the voice, the instrument, and the things that the instrument can do to fit and to actually bring forth to everybody's ears, what you want them to hear. You want them to catch the essence of the song. So, I tried my best to do that with this one, and we'll see if you guys enjoy it. We'll be right back.
Good job on working with the melody, because she ain't got no kind of time signature going on. You had to sit there and quantize everything she's singing, and that's tough for people to do, man. Well placed on that stuff, man. Band sound really good on that one. I'll set up this next one. A friend of mine sent me this tune, and I barely heard of the artist. Barely heard the tune before, but it's just one of those things that kind of stuck out. And I don't want to use the word. Well, I had to be a very good used car salesman with the band to kind of get them to realize where this tune was going. It took a minute for it to kind of sit on them and for them to realize, oh, okay, it's we can do this with this tune. So I'm gonna go with that one for this next clip. Thank you.
Cut. We're going to send this
out. All right. This is, and look, man, this is the last round, y'all watching, man. This is the final round, man. This has been an epic show right here, man. We about to get into the final round. Final round, y'all. It's back on you, Larry. I'm waiting for the clip.
Coming on through. We're going to end on some energy.
And if you got any last minute questions, shoot it to Meet Me on the 50 on Instagram. We're not gonna keep these brothers up all night, but we'll answer maybe one, two at the most. But it's late, man. We old and it's got time to go to sleep. But nah, send me a couple questions that Meet Me on the 50 on Instagram. All right, I just gotta give me a few seconds to upload. I mean to pull it up, Lur.
Oh man, no, take your time, Rick. I don't have anywhere to go, I promise you. But as it's coming up, man, this has actually really been dope. You know, I know it says the word battle in the title, but she battle every year in September. Right. So you get to see battle. This is really just refreshing on my end personally to be able to just chop it up. Shoot, stuff like this should happen more often, man. I'm still tripping that this is the first time we talked was yesterday.
After all this time, man.
That's crazy. Yeah, that's good stuff, man. Shout out to you, Eddie.
It's gonna be good next year when all of this is established, and I think people will understand connections even more after all of this. Yeah. After all, watching everybody's series and things like that. It's been shout out to Mimi on the 50. It's been a great idea, man. This was awesome.
It is.
Thank you. I appreciate y'all, fellas, man. All right, here we gonna keep it going. We gonna try to keep it going every Monday. All right, here we go. Song is up. This is Mr. Jenkins' last song of the night. Here we go.
It's good to hear the students hype, man.
Man. You
feel that energy from that ladder's a treacherous location when they get hyped like that. Man. Hey,
that was Mr. Jenkins' last song. Hey, Mr. Johnson, JP said for me to shout him out. So you said crank up from JP.
I know exactly who that is. I'm sure he's that's an interesting character right there.
All
right. But we'll go ahead and set up this last song. I do try to make sure I pay attention, like when students suggest things and all that kind of stuff. So this tune came from a tuba player, Justin, and this was his suggestion. The band latched onto it well, and you can roll the clip. Yeah, you got a shout out, Mr. Willett.
One second, bro. It's pulling up right now, Mr. Jake.
No problem.
I'm bringing me a green screen next time. I mean, look like I'm shooting in a bunker.
I'm hiding the laundry in the back. That's all.
Yeah, Man, them tuber cores was fat.
Thanks, man. I'm gonna say this about those tuba parts, because a lot of our students do ask about it, like harmony in the tuba section. You gotta be really discerning with it and use it sparingly, and realize that when you have harmony in either really high areas, like if you like piccolo harmony, the thought of that just
woo.
Or you know, super duper low on the tuba parts, it's gonna come out muddy. So you got to be considerate with it. Use it sparingly, and you know, even on that particular tune, the higher, it was in the higher register of the horn, so it wouldn't be so dirty and things like that. So you know, I want to kind of explain the method to the madness with the tuba parts there and everything.
See, it was tasteful. That's another thing too. It wasn't overdone. You know what I mean? It was right in the right spot. So when it happens, you know, it makes you kind of jump over. Oh, what's happening, man? You know what I mean?
I appreciate it.
Man, real tasteful, bro.
Thank you.
I got a question. Okay. So especially for marching band, you know, I think in concert season, woodwinds play a much larger role. But how do you utilize your woodwinds in marching band, especially with the whole loudness war being the trend in 2020? And, you know, it actually – for a while now, how do you use woodwinds in marching band?
You want to go?
Sure, I'll roll. So woodwinds in marching band, you think like a choir, just like in the brass section, you have a choir, your trumpet is the soprano instrument, your mellows, your horns, playing the alto role, trombone is a tenor, baritone voice is the baritone, tuba is the bass. You have that same type of lineup going on. Obviously, not as far with the marching band instruments we use for woodwinds, but you have your soprano clarinets, you have your piccolos in those roles. Then you have your alto saxophone, which is obviously alto, tenor sax, obviously tenor. So you're still looking at it like the voice. That's just kind of how I like to approach it. In marching band, for certain effect, you know, it might be times when you dim things down or bring the volume down so they can be heard clearly, or you put them in a certain register. Like if you bounce back to when we play Broken Clocks, mm-hmm. you know, everything kind of comes down after the intro, and you have piccolos, and you can hear the woodwinds there with all these colors just out in the open, right? And so that's one thing. Also, I think they can be used to push the sound too, and especially when it comes to that piccolo, can be used to assist with those soprano lines. And you know, you hear a piccolo across the field still. It's a woodwind instrument, but you sit across the field, you hear them. So I think they're still important in marching band. You know, it's just however you want to use them. I like to put them in the forefront at times. You might hear it in the ending. I might cut everything out, and woodwinds might sit. Again, might have dynamics to come down so they can get in there. So I think they play a big role if you want to.
I think I was just fortunate enough to be in the bands that I was in for this reason. I was in a probably 50-piece marching band in high school. Yeah. And in that 50-piece marching band, we had 13 clarinets. And they were there to be heard.
Right.
And then when I left McMain and went to Jackson State, Dr. Liddell, if you've ever met him, Dr. Liddell posed a very intimidating figure. And Dr. Liddell's principal instrument is clarinet. And he would be practicing in his office. And, you know, you could be in a practice room on the opposite side of the music building, and you felt the earth shaking a little bit, like, oh, okay, Doc's playing. Because he was aggressive. That man played the doggone heck out of that horn. You gonna hear him with the doors closed downstairs, outside while you eating chips. And you know, now, so when I became a high school and a middle school director, especially in middle school, I wanted it from my middle school clarinet players and flute piccolo players. And that attitude kind of filtered onto them. I had some aggressive clarinet, piccolo, saxophone players when I was teaching middle school, and not aggressive in the fact that they were obnoxious, but I mean aggressive in the fact that they were sitting right in front of me, and it was this one student in particular. If somebody was around her on the instrument and got something wrong, I couldn't even breathe before she was down their throat. So they had, oh man, she was massaging at arms with the flutes and the clarinets. She didn't even play flute. And, you know, coming back to Jackson State now, the woodwinds, you know, they may sit on a couple of songs, but that's just for show. They are, the piccolos, clarinets, and saxophones are bona fide sections. You know, they're full of band heads. You know, you see the song, the tuba breaks and stuff start. They're dancing the hardest. They're playing the hard. You know, they take to heart what they're doing on their instrument. So, you know, I don't look at woodwind parts like, oh, let me always copy and paste. There are some times where, you know, I really try to isolate them and use them for color, because that's a huge part to me of Jackson State sound, having that woodwind present there. And I think that, you know, I saw a couple of them down there, you know, some saxophone players. I see Mr. Ramsey, Ms. Plummer, and these folks. They really take to heart their section sound and things like that. You know, I saw a bunch of clarinet players. One of the first people I saw on the live chat was a Jackson State clarinet player. I knew exactly who she was. I was like, you know, that's my one of my hype folks. And I look at them for that. And that's how it's not just in the stands. You look at the video, if you know, you see them hype, they're playing the same way. And they are just as aggressive in symphonic band and our concert bands as well. You know, that desire to get things right and just to be a part of the band and not just sitting there, you know, skating. I guess that's the word we like to use. You know, they don't use that mentality by any stretch of the imagination.
No, I see no skating woodwind-wise in either one of these programs.
Yeah, well, one of the clarinet players, I'm going to go ahead and mess with him. He's got a clip with his native all-star band, and he's sitting up there playing a doggone clarinet like it's a bell front brass instrument. And that's just kind of the mentality that a lot of our clarinet players have. You know, they again, not just the clarinet players, you know, the entire woodwind section. I know that our sound wouldn't be what it is without their hard work and, you know, the work of the whole band program, man.
Yep, I seen that clip. He went to New Orleans All Stars.
No, he's from Memphis.
Memphis? Okay, yeah. Okay. All right. A question came in from a buddy of mine, Steve. Man, he writes music. He's the arranger over at Eastern High School in D.C.
Hey, Steve.
Yeah, his question is, what is you guys' take on high schools playing your arrangements? How does it make you feel?
I'm fine with it. I just, quite honestly, if a high school director asks me for something that I've done with the band, I'll ask them what their instrumentation is and ask them if they'd like for me to make any adjustments for it. Because again, you know, I taught middle school and I really focus hard on middle school band, trying to get the same chord extensions and harmonies and things that I would have gotten at a Jackson State. It might've been a different instrument playing them. You know, I think I learned how to use a tenor sax a completely different way when I started teaching middle school. You know, it was a baritone part before then, but then it became a part of the actual texture of the song when I started teaching middle school. You know, one of the hardest hitting tenor saxes I had, Mauro Briggs, is over there with you, man. Great guy, man. One of my old students from middle school. But, you know, those instruments for different colors, you know, if I have some tune for Jackson State that has four trombone parts and you have four trombones, that might not be the best fit for your program. So I might want to revoice some things. And I don't mind you asking, you know, if that's a high school band director, like, can we play such and such tune? You know, what's your instrumentation looking like? Do you need me to fix it or adjust it anyway?
Yeah, pretty much in the same boat too with that. Like, very open to it. You know, all for it, actually. I mean, again, they're just as much part of the community as we are. You know, even before we got to college, or I'll speak for me personally, even before I got to college, you know, I still felt linked to the community through playing the music. Like, we used to play some music from local state sometimes, you know what I mean? And I would feel connected in that sense because of it. So, you know, I echo really everything you said. I don't have too much to add, but I agree.
All right, I think this is going to be our last question right here, but I'll go ahead and two questions came in, but I'll combine them. So, during this time, this time down right now, this quarantine time or whatever you want to call it, how much arranging are y'all getting done? I'm sure you guys are getting some work done. Also, what are your projections for next season? Assuming that there is a fall season, you know, what do you see as far as band?
I guess I'll start this one. Yeah, definitely getting some things done. Also stepping into some other lanes. Definitely playing, doing some recording, some things that I'm hoping to be able to talk about soon. But you know, staying busy, you know, trying my best during this time. We just kind of sitting in the house every day. So, but yeah, definitely staying busy. And part two of that was what again?
Just, you know, the fall of 2020, you know, with uncertainty of the season, but assuming that there is going to be a band season, you know, how do you see that playing out?
Man, honestly, I wish I could answer that question a little bit clearer. I don't know. Because I don't know if things are going to change at all with being in the stadium. Like, can we sit close? I mean, I don't know, that might sound crazy, but I just don't. I don't even know. We're in such a strange time. You know, I read something from the NCAA saying that they're not putting student athletes out there if college campuses aren't open. So, you know, it's a tough one right now. If we do get to go back out, I think band, the way the culture is, we'll bounce back. We'll probably be business as usual. If we can, we get a chance to get back out there. That'll be a very positive thing to see if, you know, it's safe. But, yeah, to be honest with you, man, I just don't know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I would say this is probably the first semester or period of time since I joined band in middle school that I've been in a semester without band or anything like that. And, yeah. You know, you have some time to kind of be introspective on it, take a step back from it and just listen to music because you can listen to it. And you're not under the gun of actually getting everything down on paper right now. So, you know, was it, what they call it? Self-care is a little important. You know, I don't think that it's good, especially I think in our job, I think we've kind of trained ourselves for the demand of having to push music and do it at a quality level. But for like younger arrangers and people, you know, that might be student arrangers and things like that, don't push yourself to get so much done that you're going for quantity over quality. Like, oh, I got time off, I should be doing, you know, 15 arrangements. Do it for the practice, do it for the love of learning how to do it. But let yourself like listen to what you've done and take the time to really, like, you got time to work for quality at this point, you know. Mm-hmm. We have time to just be arrangers and musicians and artists and lovers of music at this point and listen to a big variety of things and just kind of decompress from whatever it is, you know, the pressure of having to have a show and all this other kind of stuff going on. So like if I'm arranging a tune now, it's the slowest I've ever worked and it's amazing. And it's the time where I can listen to the song, memorize it, put it on the paper and then listen to the arrangements 1700 more times and really refine things and just be okay. And, you know, as far as the season goes, we're treating it as if we are going to have business as usual, you know, as far as the routines and things on the director's end, but mm-hmm. we got to be smart about it. The students and everybody's safety is just way more important than a football season, y'all. It just, you know, it is what it is. I am ready to get back in the Memorial and see them turn and point and the J-sets kick and the drum majors backbend and all these other things. But, you know, safety's going to come first. And I'm sure everybody's taking the screening methods and, you know, we're trying to keep in contact with our students. Just, you know, every once in a while I try to reach out to just a random student and be like, hey, how you doing? Your folks okay? You know, we're using that band app thing and, you know, you could just send them a message and say, you know, how you doing? Because one thing I was telling to the music education majors especially, you know, I was actually in New Orleans right after Katrina hit. That was my first year teaching. And right after the storm hit, we all came back to school and I'm in my high school, which was red and gold and everybody's got purple and yellow uniforms and red and gray. Like it's just kids from everywhere. and you don't really realize the trauma that people go through with that type of thing. So right now, you know, people are going through these traumas and stuff with this COVID situation. You got people, you know, really, really going through some things. And we got to take that into account as directors. And, you know, I think that this HBCU football thing, when it comes back, could be just out of the box, because we're going to be so happy to see each other. This is going to be the stupidest reunion ever.
But not only that, I mean, you know, artists, they pull their inspiration from circumstance, you know. So I got a feeling this band season, if we had one, is going to be crazy as far as
absolutely
all this downtime, first of all, meaning more time to write, and then just what we dealing with, man. I mean, you know, I make beats. I'm more of on a production side, but I pull my best inspiration when I'm going through something. You know what I'm saying?
So yeah, yeah.
I think as you guys write music, it's probably the same thing, you know. So it's a lot going on right now, obviously. So
yeah.
Yeah.
Dr. Magruder told me, I tried to do a tune when I was in undergrad. And he listened to it, and he was like, man, I don't know about this one. You got to go through some things for this mm-hmm. tune to be right. Yeah. And I think that's kind of where we are. Yeah. You know, cause, and he was, I was a little pickled when he told me that. But yeah. Now that I'm a lot older from that time, like, man, he knew exactly what he was talking about.
Yeah, yeah. It's like trying to write a love song, man. You ain't never been in love before or heartbroken. How you going to know what to
do with it?
Right.
Yo, I got to get this off, because you mentioned your old band director, Dr. Liddell. Man, I had a story just remembering him from, this is 2006. Mm-hmm. We did Good Morning America in Memphis.
Okay.
And when I tell you, and this is some old school band directors where, you know, you say something to somebody in any uniform and, you know, it's just, it is what it is. Mm-hmm. And Liddell was coming through yelling at everybody. I was like, this voice was just barking. I'm like, man, yeah. Where's that coming from? But
he'll wake you on up now.
you knew who it was. I mean, you saw the suit walking up, and this is like early in the morning, going in. But I mean, it's a respect factor that you know, you have for those, especially those old school band records. I mean, I have for all band records, period. Like, I think that respect should be mutual. But and looking to those people who are pillars in the culture, you know, you definitely get that respect. So that's just something.
They weren't there by accident, man. Absolutely.
Yeah. Hey, fellas, man, I appreciate y'all time, man. This has been the third episode, y'all, of the Arrangers Battles, y'all. Any last comments you want to, like, questions have been asked. You got any questions for me, fellas? Comments?
Man, this was awesome. I appreciate the opportunity and the platform and every, you know, to work with Mr. Jenkins and just have some fun and get some music out there for the folks. I know they sitting there fiending for a season, so we appreciate it.
Hey, I see Brian Knowles in the comments, man. He needs some inspiration. Tell Brian to get up on here.
What to do, Brian? And I guess my closing, I definitely want to shout out the hometown course. Shout out all my students. The staff, the LB, shout out to you, Brother Kev, and the folks over at Jackson, my man Lowell. Shout out to Ada Zai Symphonians and Ada Omega KK Sai at Howard and all the news. And then my last thing, my wife is graduating with her MBA, next week. So I want to shout out.
On the congratulations, man.
Appreciate it. On that accomplishment, man. Shout out to your queen. So shout out to her.
Absolutely. All right. Hey, look. We going to go ahead. Tomorrow night, actually. Tomorrow's Tuesday. I need y'all to tune back in. PJ Howard, assistant band director from Alabama State, now Alabama State, formerly Stillman College, will be on the show for the Director's Corner, man. So tune in tomorrow at 8 p.m. Central Standard Time, 9 p.m. Eastern. And with that, unless y'all have any other comments, we going to head up out of here, fellas.
All right, y'all take care. Be safe.
Peace.
Yes, sir.
Ready, caller.
Time to go watch some marching band.